Welcome to the second webinar of the ALIA series, Tools for Transformation, highlighting some of the most promising frameworks, tools, and ideas that are being prototyped and refined across the ALIA network. I am your host, Adrienne McCurdy, and we have with us today Glenda Eoyang, the founder of Human System Dynamics and Adaptive Action. I would love to just welcome you, Glenda. I had the pleasure of meeting Glenda at last year's ALIA Summer Institute. I did a module with her, so we had 5 days together where I got to really dive into adaptive action. And I remember the first time when I read the description, I just thought, wow, this is amazing. I really want to do this. And then I sat in on maybe the first few minutes of it, and I thought, and there's a quick overview, and I thought, well, this is quite simple. Okay, I don't know how we're going to have 5 days of this. And then by the end of the 5 days, it was just phenomenal. All of our minds were blown at the profound depth that this work goes. And so just wanted to share that with everyone as well. And Glenda, she's quite accomplished. She's written 5 books. She's been the most recent being Adaptive Action, Leveraging Uncertainty in Your Organization, as well as Radical Rules for Schools. And she's been with ALIA every year since 2009. And she'll be again with us at the Summer Leadership Intensive in Tacoma this June, if you wanted to go further into this work with her as well. And she leads a network of 450 practitioners, and they apply adaptive action to everything from public policy, advocacy, product design, education, and healthcare reform, and parenting. So it's a very diverse tool that we can use. So welcome, Glenda.
Thank you very much, Adrienne. I'm really pleased to be here. And thank you, ALIA, for doing this lovely series of opportunities for people to dig into content and ideas and perspectives and images that people may feel very distant from. So thank you for making this available to folks, and thanks to everybody for being here. I hope that you will share your questions and comments as we move along through this process of adaptive action. So welcome, everybody. I'm going to close my video here so that we can see what is happening. Excellent. So we're going to be talking today about particularly what we call adaptive action. It's what we think is the future of leadership. And we begin with this idea of generation flux. There was a series of articles that were in Fast Company a couple of years ago by Robert Sethian about generation flux or gen flux. There are people and there are organizations that seem genetically prepared for fast and unpredictable change. And he called them gen flux. And I have a question for you that I'd like to begin with. How many of you consider yourselves to be gen flux? So if we can open that poll for 3 minutes, we'll ask you to respond. How many of you consider yourselves to be members of generation flux, gen flux? Good. I have to say, as you're answering the poll, my 60th birthday was a couple of weeks ago, and so for all practical purposes, I really shouldn't be a member of Gen Flux, and I probably wasn't when I was 20 years old. But in the last 3 or 4 years, as the world has continued to shift and change, and I've tried to shift and change with it, and learn from adaptive action, I think I've entered Gen Flux here in the last decades of my life. So thank you. Hope everybody's had a chance to respond to the poll. We have 51% yes. Oh, excellent. 26% of us and 23% are wondering what. Excellent. Okay. Good. Go ahead and vote as you will. Excellent. So as we talk about what is Gen Flux, there are many people who talk about change that is complex and breathtaking, overwhelming change, unpredictable change. That's flux. But Gen Flux is able not just to think and talk about unpredictable change, but they're also able to take adaptive action in it. So if you are able to see patterns in rapid change, understand those patterns in ways that are meaningful, and then make choices to move forward in productive ways, then that makes you a member of Gen Flux. So if you think about the last surprise you had, or change that moved you, or something that came completely unexpectedly, that's flux. And the question is not, will those things happen or not? The question is, when they happen, what do you do? That's what we're going to be talking about today. Thank you. So let's begin thinking and talking about what it means to deal with generation flux. What we're going to do today is to look at three things. We're going to ask ourselves, what is this ability to deal with adaptive change? So what does it mean for the choices we make and the options we have? And now what will you do? So by the end of this brief hour, we're going to ask you to make an action plan for what you're going to do to build your adaptive capacity over time and in future. So let's begin with what. We talk about change, we talk about unpredictable change, but what does that really mean? How do you experience change? Well, one of the things we've realized as we talk about not just thinking about change, but acting in it adaptively, we've realized there are three different kinds of change. Three different kinds of change we have to see, understand, and influence. And each one requires a very different action and intervention and skill. The first one is called static change, and it looks a little like this. In static change, you assume that the system is still and stable before you begin, and that your job is to push it in a direction, at a speed, to an outcome that you choose. Maybe you can't push it by yourself and you have to have other people come help you push. Maybe the direction that you're going, the system doesn't want to go that way and it pushes back on you. But if you think about change in human systems in this way, you're thinking and working with what we call static change. Now, it's pretty obvious that human systems don't really change this way. If you have a team that's not performing and you want that team to perform, you can't push it toward high performance and get it to work. But still, in many of our change efforts, in many of our actions in human systems, we behave as if we're going to push the system to a new place. So consider outcome evaluation. So you're beginning a project, you state what your outcomes are going to be, you build your log frame plan for the path to get there, and you begin to push. And your expectation and everyone else's is that you're going to end up at the place you predict. That's thinking as static change. A second is to think about performance objectives. Underperforming employee, we want to make them performing, let's push. Or team improvement, or the one that I find most challenging is to say, we're going to change our culture. If we just push in the right direction, we will change our culture. So even though we know that human systems don't work that way very often, we treat them as if we do. So I'd like to ask, have you seen this kind of change in your human systems? Do you think sometimes of change as being static? If the answer is yes, would you please raise your hand? If you sometimes think of making change as the opportunity to push a system up a line, would you please raise your hand? Say, yeah, that's what I see. Yeah, we see several people who are beginning to say, yeah, that's the way I see change. And I would like to ask Darcy Farlow. Darcy, if you have voice, Darcy Farlow, would you please, if you have voice, we'll unmute you. And I'll invite you to tell us a little bit. First, say who you and where you are. And then tell us a little bit about the way that you experience static change. So, Darcy, you've been unmuted. Let's see if we can hear you. Well, apparently not. So I invite everyone who has your hand up to be thinking about particular examples of static change. Now, this isn't bad. It's just that it doesn't always work. If it works, it's great. But it doesn't always work. And when it doesn't, you need another option. Is that Darcy?
Why don't we hear, no, this is Adrian. Why don't we hear from Suzanne Mitten?
Great.
Suzanne, are you there? So we're talking about adaptive action, right? Glenda, we're not able to, for some reason when I'm unmuting people, they're not able to speak. So perhaps
okay.
We can just keep adapting.
That's right. Well, what I'll ask then is if you jot down the things that you're thinking along the line, and we will continue the conversation online on the ALIA website, the ALIA social networking site. So jot down whatever you want to say, and we'll have a continuing conversation on the site after the webinar. So that's static change. No naughty or nice, just does it work. The second kind of change is called dynamic change. And it was given to us, these are the characteristics of static change. You move from one point to another. You don't pay any attention to what happens during the change process. The main problem you bump into is resistance. The system will push you back. And the automatic response is to push harder. But the problem with that is when the system is pushing back and you push harder, the system pushes harder too. Examples are outcome management. Often we think about motivation this way. The carrot and the stick is a static way to think about change. And moving from one office to another, one place to another, is a static change. Turning mics on and off is also a static change. So I invite you all to put your hands down now. We'll have you a chance to do some voting, more voting a bit later. So the second kind of change is called dynamic change.
And
yes,
actually,
Adrian?
Just would you be able to put your webcam on? There have been several requests that people want to see your beautiful face.
Oh, sure.
Thank you.
Well, I'm happy to put the webcam on. I don't know about beautiful face, but let's see. Start my webcam. It's been paused. We'll move forward. There we go. How's that? So I could turn the camera around and you could see a major snowstorm outside, but we won't do that.
And then also so the screen sharing
change.
As well. And the screen sharing as well. Please.
So it's not showing the screen? Show my screen. It should be showing the screen. Is it now showing the screen and my face? Adrian, does that get them both?
Yes, it does. Thank you.
I will assume the answer is yes. Okay. So dynamic change. And it was Newton who taught us about dynamic change. This is change that allows you to move from a beginning point that is well known, well understood, very clear, to one that is not known, one that is predictable and structured someplace in the future. And you know what the path is. So if you think about starting with a softball in your hand, you know the weight of the ball, you know your strength, you know the direction you want to throw it. You throw it, and you know the path that it's going to travel and where it's going to land. That's dynamic change. Now that too sometimes shapes the way we think of change in human organizations. Think, for example, about project management. So you start a project, you know everything you can know at the beginning, you plan milestones and steps and deliverables and project schedule and tasks, and you assume that at some time in the future, predicted time, you're going to end up at a place, predicted place, with predictable outcomes and products. So project management takes that idea of dynamic change and applies it to human systems. Now again, that's not bad. Sometimes it works. We also think about developmental steps as dynamic change. You've heard that teams begin forming, storming, norming, performing. That's assuming that a team follows a smooth curve of performance. Or we think about a professional development plan, where we have step A, step B, step C, step D, and what we're going to end up with is something that is predictable. We used to think about careers as dynamic change. Wherever you started, you're going to do your work, and then you were going to retire. We were all going to retire at 65, end of story. Not a bad thing if it happens, but the challenge is even the best made plans go astray. Have you ever had a project that worked exactly as you expected it to? Have you ever had a team that moved from beginning to end in a smooth path? Have you ever yourself planned a process of personal change or growth and moved forward smoothly? I haven't even been able to plan a vacation that works that way, or a trip. Now, it's helpful to think of change in this way because it gets people together. It allows you to prepare for the future. It's really a good way to think about change. But often, change as we live it doesn't follow this path. Some characteristics of dynamic change are smooth path. You know the initial starting point and you can predict the end. The problem, though, is that if you think about change this way, it becomes disrupted. And what do you do when it gets disrupted? Well, I'll tell you what I did. The first time I had a project plan, my first project, it was a beautiful plan, very detailed, very complete. And after about 6 weeks, something happened I didn't predict. And the first thing I did was to blame someone. If you had told me, I would have included that, but if you were doing what you were supposed to do, blah, 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 if, and then I realized, well, that's not very productive. Maybe I should just blame myself if I had been a better planner, if I had kept things under control. Then I realized, well, that didn't help much either. That was when I realized we needed a third kind of change. So examples of dynamic change, project management, stages of change. So many of the theories about change give you a process step by step. They're not bad, they're a good way to start, but expect to be thrown off scale. So if you read one of those change books and it says this is the first stage, that's the second stage, this is the third, fourth, fifth stage of change, that's helpful. And hold it lightly because something is going to disrupt and you need a way to respond to that disruption in a productive way. At least you do if you're going to be a productive member of Gen Flux. Now, static and dynamic change are great for those of us who lived, grew up, new times of smooth and gentle and predictable change. But for those of us who live in unpredictable change, these two ways of thinking and acting just aren't enough. That's why we introduced the third kind of change. Mathematicians call it dynamical change. That's kind of an ugly word. Sometimes we call it complex change. But it is a third kind of change that looks a bit like Tahrir Square. In dynamical change, the human system is moving all the time. It never stops. You can never know enough about it to be able to predict what's going to happen next. No matter how much data you collect, you can't predict when or how the change is going to happen. All you can know is that there's tension accumulating. And sometimes the tension accumulates within the system, between the agents. They talk to each other, they get frustrated, they get angry, they run into police, they whatever. Together, they get hungry, they get frustrated, they get angry. Sometimes the tension comes from outside the system, that cell phones are suddenly available, or political decisions are made. As we watch what's happening in Ukraine today, there are decisions that are being made by the government outside the circle of people who are rebelling that are influencing the choices, the speed and direction of this dynamical change. Now, the dynamical change can happen at multiple scales. So each individual person may be satisfied and peaceful, then may become dissatisfied, and then unpeaceful. And each of those is a dynamical shift in the pattern of the system. It also happens with pairs and groups, subsets, and with the group as a whole. And it also happens beyond national bounds, so that around the world, people are responding in ways that are dynamical. And each time one dynamical shift happens, at whatever scale, it influences other scales, up, down, all around. So this is the kind of patterns that we see in social change efforts. But we see the same kind of thing at a very small scale. So think about the last time you learned something new. You were perfectly happy with what you knew, seemed to work. That was the way Adrienne came into our class, right? So she was curious about what might happen, but she had a sense of what change looked like and how she should work with change. And when we began the class, as she said, those ideas like adaptive action and three kinds of change seemed really kind of simple. But as she thought about them, as she had experiences, as she reflected, as she moved her physical sense, as she saw extra possibilities, the tension began to grow, and she would have ahas, dynamical change. She'd have a little aha. Somebody else in the room would have a breakthrough aha and talk about it, which would feed into hers. And so that our learning in that time together was a dynamical change process. We talk about the whole, change at the whole, the part, and the greater whole. And if you're within a complex system, you are both influencing and influenced by unpredictable dynamical change of all kinds. It is this kind of change that you build capacity for as you enter Gen Flux, Generation Flux. So as you think about dynamical change, the characteristic is that the tension builds and releases over time. So any point that you're aware emotionally, that you're building tension, building frustration, or it's not always negative. Let's talk about one where it's positive. Think about the last time you fell in love. Maybe the only time you fell in love. Or maybe the next time you fall in love. You kind of like the person, that's kind of nice. They do something really nice. They do something else. You talk to somebody else and they say something nice about them. You read something, or you get a rose on Valentine's Day, or. And each of these experiences, a nice long conversation, a chat, a touch, each of these contributes to the building tension in your heart that is getting ready for a dynamical change, which is a falling in love. And that too is a dynamical process. Really lovely, really exciting. The change may not be obvious for a while. it may be hidden inside the system, or it may be happening and pushed outside the system. It may look like nothing's changing. And then reaches a critical point and the change bursts through. The main problem is that this is unpredictable. You cannot predict when or how the breakthrough is going to happen. You remember those old movies of the two people who hate each other at the beginning? Katharine Hepburn was great with those, right? So hate, change, fight, jerk, really disrupted relationship at the beginning. And by the end, they're in love. So it's that kind of transition that we see happening. You can't predict it unless you've seen the movie before. But you know that something exciting is going to be happening, but you don't know if it's positive or negative. How do you deal with that? You watch for patterns. You begin to see indicators that the tension is growing. You begin to realize that things are shifting. You begin to recognize or respond physically and thoughtfully to the changes in the system, the little subtle ones that are building tension. In the HSD network, Human Systems Dynamics Network, this is one of the reasons why we value mindfulness so much in leadership, is that when you are mindful, watching, breathing, totally aware and awake, you're more likely to be able to see the weak signals of transformation that's on the way. We've talked about ahas and learning as examples of dynamical change. Innovation is another one. So you can't say, on Tuesday at 4 o'clock, be innovative. You go from not innovative to innovative. It's just not a static change. You also can't plan your way into innovation. If we brainstorm and then we select and then we look at options and then we look at problems and then we get to the end, there's no guarantee that that kind of a dynamic process is going to give us innovation. Innovation is this accumulation of issues and ideas and possibilities over time, growing, getting deeper and stronger until the aha invention appears. Economic shifts are also dynamical change. Now, the problem is that economists don't have much intelligence yet about how to talk about or think about dynamical change. But anyone who looks back at the crash of 2008 or any other major economic transformation will see that there were accumulating signals many places, many times, many ways, and that the shift, the change, was a breakthrough, a major breakthrough. So I'm curious about which kinds of change you encounter most in your life and work. So let's do a quick poll. Thinking about static, dynamic, and dynamical change, I'm curious about which of these changes you see in your life and work. So can we open the poll, please?
The poll should be open.
Good. Thank you. So as you're watching the poll, oh, isn't that interesting? Oh, we didn't talk about parenting. So anyone who has had a baby in the household, or especially lived with a two-year-old, knows the way that dynamical change shifts. You also know that if you're very familiar with that child, you're more likely to be able to anticipate when and how there's going to be a tantrum. Now, you still can't predict when, you still can't control it, keep it from happening, but intelligence of the system, practice with the system, helps you know and see, anticipate what's going to happen. The critical piece in generation flux is not to say that one of these kinds of change is better than another, They're all good. They're all useful. The question is, which is fit to purpose? If you're working in a dynamical change space, does it make sense? Is it useful to set up a static change? You have a teenager who's misbehaving and you're really worried about them. Dynamical change, but it might still be useful to set curfew, static intervention, be home by 9, as a way to help you work in this dynamical space. But don't expect that to be complete and sufficient. So the question is, are you capable of, have you built skills that support each of these points? Have you built the wisdom and the mindfulness to think about which one is fit to particular purpose? And are you able to shift from one to another as you need to make a change over time? Three kinds of change. Now, a high percentage of people experience dynamical change, and yet everything we hear and understand about dealing with change in organizations, most of it, deals with static change or dynamic change. And the reason is that even though we experience dynamical change, we had no theory base, no language to talk about that in a scientific way. And so people who dealt well with dynamical change were seen as being kind of magical or intuitive or especially gifted. And either you had that gift or you didn't have that gift. And if you didn't, too bad. Or you could work in a mentoring kind of role to develop the gifts of seeing and noticing and responding. One of the things that we do in human systems dynamics is to talk about that kind of change, the surprising, unpredictable change, in a way that is more accessible to people, that you can think and talk about dynamical change as you experience it without having some kind of private personal gift. This is one of the reasons why our models and methods are so incredibly simple, very simple, to invite everyone into that conversation. So what I'd like to do is to share with you some of the characteristics of dynamical systems and to think about the ways in which you might use them to leverage your dynamical capacity, your gen flux capacity. So we're going to talk about the nature of leadership, the so what in our adaptive action. What is dynamical change? So what does that mean to your choices in action? So dynamical change is patterned. So if you think about the process of falling in love or building a team or raising a child, those systems are patterns. There are similarities that tell you about it. There are differences that move it forward. There are connections that tell you what's happening inside the system. So the more you can understand about the patterns of health and coherence and productivity and possibility, learning, happiness, in the dynamical system you're a part of, the more you can know what patterns you want, notice what patterns appear, and think about how you can influence those patterns, amplifying the ones that exist, looking for the ones that are positive, celebrating those and moving forward. So you're probably aware of appreciative inquiry as one kind of organizational and community intervention. Well, the secret of appreciative inquiry is that it's a process for uncovering, discovering patterns of possibility in a group. And so AI is a way to discover those patterns and to reinforce those patterns that are healthy and positive and strong. So any tools, models, skills that you have that help you see patterns and amplify the ones that you want are working in and will be supportive of your growth and change in dynamical work. That's one characteristic. The second is that these systems are sensitive to initial conditions. Sorry about the technical sound of that. It's what the scientists call, what we call, butterfly effects. So the idea is that these systems, these complex dynamical systems, build up tension until some small change can cause them to collapse and shift. Sensitive to initial conditions. The butterfly effect. So you'll notice that all of those human systems that you live and work in, that you recognize as dynamical, you can probably remember the moment when the tension broke through. You may remember the thing that seemed to be the ignition for a change. Now, we may think and talk about social change as being caused by a particular thing. So Rosa Parks, for example, in the US, in civil rights movement, we can say that the marches and the civil rights movement in Montgomery, Alabama, began with Rosa Parks sitting in the front of the bus. But people who are familiar with that real transformation know that that change started decades before, and that Rosa Parks had been, along with her colleagues, taught, practiced in nonviolent communications, in nonviolent response, and that they were prepared, the system was prepared to be moved, to move itself when a butterfly struck. And so it just happened that that courageous act, that one courageous act among many courageous acts, was at a time and a place that shifted that change into a dynamical space. So as a leader, what you can do is to watch the system build its tension, watch for the things that might be triggering it, watch for the things that might be butterflies. And when you see a little one that might be moving in the right way, you can amplify it, strengthen it, speak to it, tell stories about it, point it out, repeat it, encourage it. Butterfly effects. A third thing that we see in complex systems is that they are scale-free. Now, what this means is that the patterns that you see at one level in the system, you'll also see at other levels. So that's why I've been able, as we've talked together today, to talk sometimes about my own internal feelings, sometimes about a one-on-one friendship or love relationship, or about a team, or about a company, or about a nation, or about an international movement. It's all the same. And dynamical change at one affects this level above and below. And so if you begin to see a pattern and think about a pattern, you can begin to, at multiple scales, you can begin to think about how to move it. So I've done a good bit of work with the federal government in the U.S. on child abuse and neglect. How do you prevent child abuse and neglect? Well, if you think about it as a pattern, not as a problem that that parent is dysfunctional or that that family is dysfunctional, but if you think about abuse and neglect as a pattern, and you think about where else in our culture does that pattern of abuse and neglect appear, and what might we be able to do to treat abuse and neglect at another scale? And how can I set those conditions in a larger scale or a smaller scale that would interfere with or shift or transform that dynamical shift that makes a parent who loves her children tremendously, a father who cares what happens to their kids in a moment of anger or frustration or hopelessness, go through a dynamical change that is a breakthrough of violence or meanness to their children? So maybe we would decide to work on the education system. Maybe we would decide to work on poverty. Maybe we'd even do a State of the Union address about income inequality. One might. Scale free. So as a leader, you need to be watching multiple scales, multiple levels at which patterns emerge, and wonder which one can you touch to make the biggest change. The next characteristic, high dimension. So these systems have many, many variables. It's not just about speed. It's not just about quality. It's not just about cost. It's not just about height or openness or clarity or intelligence or sensitivity or history or background or physical health. Physical health isn't just about my blood pressure, but it's about my blood pressure and my heart rate and my ions and my muscle tension and my bone strength. So these systems are high dimension. And all of those dimensions are interrelated, so that if I change one, I can change another. So if we think about physical, mental, social health, if I strengthen my mental health, my social and physical health reasonably would change as well. They're interlocking patterns in a dynamical system. If I change my physical health, my mental health, my social health are likely to change as well. That in these massively entangled dynamical systems, it's perfectly logical to recognize that these systems, though in very different material existences, would be interdependent and would cause those relationships to shift. These are high dimension systems. Finally, these systems are perpetual. Don't you like that? Finally, they're perpetual. A perpetual change means that it is never over. There's no beginning and there is no end. That the change that we see today depends on all of the changes that have happened that have led up to it. Every single change previously has set the conditions for the change that we face today. And our flux today and how we respond to it sets the conditions for all the flux that will follow from here into a future we cannot even imagine. So to think that in a dynamical system you're going to solve a problem, we're going to be done with that, it'll be gone, we'll feed all the children, or we'll stop smallpox, or we'll make the perfect team, it's a delusion. It's thinking about that change as if it were static or dynamic, where there is an end. Perpetual change is a constant evolution, shifting, accumulation of tension, release of tension. Accumulation, release here, accumulation, release there, at this scale, at that scale. This change is a perpetual change. And so as a member of Gen Flux, you have to prepare yourself at every moment, in every place, to be thinking about and responding to and interacting with whatever the tension is, whatever the potential is, for wherever you are in that moment. Dynamical change, Gen Flux, is perpetual. So as you think about these five characteristics, many, many, many variables, patterns that emerge over time, patterns at multiple levels in the system that resonate or reflect each other, butterfly effects, where a very small cause can have an enormous effect, and perpetual change, where this moment is simply the next in a whole cluster of moments moving forward. So I'd like to go to another poll and to ask you, of these kinds of change, which of the ones do you find most challenging? As you have seen these, all of them are equally challenging. So it's interesting that mostly we see and feel dynamical change, and we find it most challenging. And as you look at these five characteristics of dynamical change, which of course are not true, either of static or dynamic, you can see quickly the ways in which our challenges with dynamical change carry us into what the possibilities are. I'm curious to see that some of you think about static change as being the most challenging. Often when you see a thing that you want to change and you want to be able to change it, then being able to push, find the power, find the standing, find the lever to move can be very challenging as well. So if we see them as very challenging, all of these, 77% of you find either all of them or the dynamical change most challenging. Then let's ask, which of these kinds of patterns, of the patterns, do you see in your perspective? So that poll is closed. So I'd like to start another poll. If you would open the other poll, that is, which of those patterns, high dimension, pattern, scale-free, perpetual, sensitive to initial conditions, which of those do you tend to see most in your dynamical change? And pick as many as you can. You can don't just have to pick one. Pick as many as you have noticed. Do you see your most challenging changes as dealing with many differences all at the same time? Do you see yourself facing the same kind of challenge over and over? Or something happens and you think, oh, it's that again. How many of your dynamical changes deal with inside, between, among, the whole, the part in the greater whole is scale free? How often do you see individual support or change, small changes causing big ones? And how many of you find yourselves constantly living in and living with challenges perpetually? Now, none of these are better or worse, but if you expect static or dynamic outcomes, predictable, structured, controlled outcomes, and you're living and working in a system that's high dimension and patterned and scale free and perpetual and sensitive to initial conditions, you cannot succeed. To succeed in a dynamical space, to be a productive member of Gen Flux, you have to be able to think about the ways in which all of these pieces move and work at the same time, move and work together. So I hope that what you're doing in your space, since we can't hear you for sure, I'm very curious about what questions are coming up. So I'm going to ask Adrian to share, to summarize questions that we've heard. So Adrian, will you join us, please, by voice and face, if you can?
Hi. Okay, we have some great questions here. Let's go to the top one. This first one is from Elsa Silva, and she asks, what skills of observations should I develop to see and understand the dynamical changes that occur in an organization while I'm mostly busy with the dynamic changes?
Oh, lovely question. Yeah, lovely question. So there are two things that I would suggest. One is to build a habit of zooming in and zooming out. Some people talk about going to the balcony, but if you can get accustomed to, in a moment, zoom in, look at details, focus on particulars, think about a single person at a place and time, and then zoom back out and see the pattern of the whole. Zooming in and zooming out is a capacity that lets you see and expect tension where it's going to land. The second thing is to look for patterns. When we say pattern, we mean something very specific. Look at how things are alike. What are the similarities? Look at how things are different, and look at how things are connected. So that gives you a pattern. Similarities, differences, and connections are the way we define pattern. So if you can learn, no matter how confused or messy something is, you can always see what's the same. And you can see what's different. And you can see if things are connected. So those are the two capacities that I think would be best. Lovely question. Thank you.
Great. And the second question is from Suzanne Mitten. And she asks, I'm reminded of the notion of positive deviant. Would you see stories of positive deviance as a tool or skill for leaders to consider in encouraging change?
Absolutely, yes, yes. So for those of you who don't know about positive deviance, the idea is that in a complex system, there's likely to be someone who is thriving. And they're called the positive deviant. Now, often they're doing something that is against the rules because everybody else is following the rules and not thriving. So if you can zoom in and find, this is a really good example of zooming in, by the way. If you can zoom in and find the person who's really thriving in a complex system, question the positive deviant, see what they're doing, and learn from them. And there's a lovely process for doing this, and it is a great thing to use in dynamical change.
Okay, let's just take one more question because we'll have to start wrapping up soon. The next question is from Toby. Oh, I'm sorry, I can't pronounce the last name. I'm probably going to butcher this, but Herzilch. Why is butterfly effect called initial conditions? Can you explain that more?
Yes, I can. It has to do with the way that the butterfly effect was discovered. It was in a weather simulation. So a fellow had done a really, his name is Lawrence, he had done a really interesting simulation of the weather. It had lots of variables, lots of interactions. It was a wonderful dynamical system. And he set it rolling. It was back when computers were really slow and it took a long time for the simulation to say what the weather would be. So it started and it was going, 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 and it got someplace and it broke. And he said, oh, so I fixed it. And he started it again at what he thought was exactly the same place. And he started it going. He thought that this was a dynamic change and that it would follow the path. And pretty soon it started to deviate and it went way off and ended up in a very different place. And he said, but we started in the same place, and the equations are all the same. How could we have gotten to a different place? So he looked very, very, very closely, and he realized that the starting condition was something like 0.000001 different in case one and case two. And that little difference in the initial conditions, everything else being the same, that little difference in the initial conditions had sent one trajectory of weather off one direction, the other off the other way. And so he called it sensitivity to initial conditions. But the first time he gave a talk, he said, and nobody's going to understand what that means. Let's say that if a butterfly flapped his wing, that little bit of turbulence might be amplified, multiplied, increased by the rest of the system until it turns into a hurricane off the coast of Florida. So it was the way he dramatized the technical idea. That's where it came from. That may be more science than you wanted to hear. So thank you for all of your questions. And Adrian, before you go, can I ask if it is okay for us to continue this conversation with questions and responses on the ALIA social network site?
Yes, absolutely. If everyone looks at their chat screen, if they happen to be calling in, they can see that the handles for Twitter and for Facebook, well, I guess Facebook, we don't have the link up there, but the Twitter handles for both Glenda as well as Human System Dynamics, Adaptive Action, and ALIA as well. And let's just take a few minutes just to recap a few things. Glenda, did you have a slide for your book and you just wanted to show people the book? And
yes, what I'd like to do, if I might, is to walk through Adaptive Action very quickly.
Okay.
What we have done today is adaptive action. We have looked at what was present.
Yeah.
We have talked about what patterns are present, what constrains the patterns, what energizes them, what perspectives. That's adaptive action, the first step. Adaptive action, the second step, was so what? So what is working? So what's not? So what's possible? So what's happening above and below? So what are the options for action? And the final step is now what? Now what will we do? Now what have we learned? Now what to communicate? Now what to look for next? And those three steps are the most important ways to thrive in dynamical change. What are the patterns? So what do they mean? Now what will you do? So, and then you begin again. Next what? Because everything you do shifts the system, increases the tension, and moves you forward. So I invite you to read Adaptive Action. This book came out April of last year. And in it, Royce Holiday and I talk about how you use this to leverage uncertainty in your organization. I also invite you to visit adaptiveaction.org, which is our blog site. And there you can download various papers and pieces. You can also share information there. We also have certification training. I invite you to explore that. But mostly, I would like for you to join the Leadership Intensive at ALIA when we get together this summer. So I'll turn that back to Adrian. So
okay.
Thank you, Adrian.
Yeah, thank you. So in a moment, we're actually going to go back to Glenda for closing inspiration. And I just had a few things to share with you before that about the upcoming webinars and as well as how to find information about this webinar. Glenda, would you want to click forward to the slide? The next one, please.
To this one? There
yes,
you go.
Please.
The next webinar.
All right. So the next webinar that's coming up is with Bill Sharp. And he's going over Three Horizons, which is a fantastic framework for understanding work. And I really value what he has, well, him and the colleagues at the International Futures Forum, what they have put together there. And so I know that that's going to be a fantastic call. And then we also have Adam Kahane at doing transformative scenario planning. And you can visit aliainstitute.org, and that is where you can sign up for any of that information. And you can also see the past webinars. So this video will be available to you there, as well as Glenda's slides. If Glenda, I'm sorry, I didn't check before. Is that okay to share your slides?
Absolutely. We give all of our intellectual property away. So
fantastic.
Yes.
Fantastic. Great. So those slides will also be available there. And then Glenda, could you please flip forward to the next slide?
Yes.
Thank you. Okay, and as Glenda mentioned, we also have the Leadership Intensives, which is a 5-day submersion in a community of practice, and it's a really valuable learning experience. It blends the mindfulness practice, so every morning starts off with a mindfulness practice. Sometimes it might be sitting, and other times it's through movement and just becoming present. And then we take the presence that we gain from the morning and we apply that into our social impact. And then we get to work with fantastic people such as Glenda, we also have in the one in the Netherlands, we have Zaid and Bill, who both are giving webinars, as well as, I think our faculty is around 20 incredible thought leaders there. And then we also have the one that's coming up in Tacoma. So the Netherlands one is from March 23rd to 29th, and Tacoma, Washington on the West Coast is from June 8th to 13th, and that's the one that Glenda will be at. So if something sparked inside of you in Glenda's presentation, I really highly encourage you to register so you can actually register for her webinar to guarantee your spot. And also, we'll have Charles Eisenstein will be joining us. He from Sacred Economics, and he will also be hosting a session as well. And we'll have Dan Siegel joining us by video. And after that, Glenda, do you have any final inspirations or final thoughts that you want to leave us with?
Well, first, I want to thank all of you who, like the ALIA Institute, see patterns as they emerge within you and between and among, understand them in ways that are actionable, and then take courageous action to shift those patterns and set the context for the rest of us in this world in which we live, this Gen Flux world. So thank you.
Mm-hmm. And thank you everyone for joining us as well. Mm-hmm. Great. Okay, well, that's it for this webinar, and we hope to see you at future webinars. Thank you, everyone, for joining us, and please continue the conversation on Twitter or on Facebook. Thank you. Take care.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.